as I was looking back, as we've been going through the book of Mark, it's amazing how God just took care of that, because I can't think of a better topic to deal with the Sunday after Easter than the topic of grace. God's grace. As a matter of fact, if you think about it, every time we come together and worship, we ought to do it with Easter in mind, with Easter in our vision, with Easter in our memory, the fact that we are serving a risen, living Savior. There are religions all over the world. They're going through the motions, and they're worshiping a dead God. But our God's not dead. Jesus Christ rose from the grave, and he's alive. And so it changes our worship. So today we want to look at the grace of God. We're going to be traveling with Jesus and his disciples, and we're going to come to two destinations that he comes to in the book of Mark chapter 7. And I think in both of these we will see two truths about the grace of God. Now, I want to tell you, grace is more than just salvation. We know we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, but grace goes beyond salvation. It is an important part. It is the only way we can be saved. But folks, we're living under grace today. And in our Christian walk, we need grace. You know, Jerry and I were privileged to be able to go to the Casting Crowns concert this last week. Some of you were there. This weekend we went over to get Jerry's cell phone exchanged and got her a new one, which she's locked out of right now and has no idea how to work it. It's smarter than she is, so she didn't sleep much last night. But here, as I was standing there talking to the lady at ATT, she's in the nursery, so I can get by with that now. But We were standing there at ATT talking to the sales lady that was helping us, the technician that was helping us with all this, and of course she knew she was working and where I was, and it was the First Baptist account she had open, and she was doing some things for us, and she said, "Did you go to the Casting Crowns concert?" And I said, "Yeah, I sure did." And she said, "Man, I just loved it." And she was going through all this stuff with it. And she said, "Weren't they great?" And I said, "Let me tell you, what I really love about them is that they're not just doing concerts." See, Mark, the lead singer, said this. He said, "Everybody on that platform were ministers in their home churches, youth ministers, most of them." And he said, "We're in our home churches from Sunday morning through Wednesday night. And then we go on the road Thursday, Friday, and Saturday." And see, you pick up a lot of that in their music. Because if you listen to Casting Crowns music, they're talking about and singing about real events that have taken place in the lives of people they love and they minister to. And then they're talking about how God's grace is the answer to that and how God works through that. And there's that connection back to the local church. But I thought about this as I was going over the sermon again this morning, is that when we think about the grace of God, and I... You know, we think about it for salvation, but what about the real life where we live? As I listen to their testimony, you look at those guys up there on the stage, and they've got all the lights and all the loud music and all the special effects. But they showed one of the videos, and one of the songs was written about the issue of one of their guitarists' baby who had to have a heart transplant. And one of the songs was around that event. Folks, to go through something like that, you've got to have the grace of God. Amen. Another one, Laura Story came out, and she sings that song, Blessings. She told us that the reason that song was written, her husband, that they had only been married a short time, and he had a brain tumor. And he had to have brain surgery. And she said, "I came into the room, and the doctors had told her he may have no memory when the surgery is over." She said, after the surgery, she walked into the room in his recovery room, and he looked at her and he goes, "You're Laura Story." And she thought, "Oh, he remembers me." He just didn't remember he was married to her. And so they're going through all that, and she's got a little baby and still on the road and pregnant with twins now. And but she wrote that song around that, saying that you got to have the grace of God to go through things like that. And we could take those same things that we have in our lives and apply that to. So I want us to see how it lives out and what we can take and pull out of Mark chapter 7 of where we live today. Would you stand with me as we read Mark chapter 7, beginning with verse 24. He got up and departed from there to a region in Tyre and Sidon. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know it, but he could not escape notice. Instead, immediately after hearing about him, a woman whose little girl or little daughter had an unclean spirit came and fell at his feet. Now the woman was Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to drive the demon out of her daughter. And he said to her, "Allow the children to be satisfied." Very strange statement here. "Allow the children to be satisfied first, because it isn't right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." But she replied to him, "Lord, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." And he told her, "Because of this reply, you may go. The demon has gone out of your daughter." And when she went back to her home, she found her child laying on the bed, and the demon was gone. Lord God, thank you for your word. Lord, we know your Holy Spirit is here today. So God, I pray that your Holy Spirit will take your word and apply it to our lives, that we will be different because we have been confronted with truth, and we have been confronted with the grace of God today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The first thing that I want us to see today through this passage is that the grace of God is within our reach. It is within our reach. Now, we aren't really sure why Jesus made this stop. Obviously, it wasn't for a preaching engagement or a teaching engagement, because he didn't want anybody to know he was there. He was trying to slip into town. You ever done that? Especially if you live somewhere away from your hometown and you just want to slip in, you just can't do that. And so obviously his reputation, I started to say followed him, but I guess preceded him. People knew who he was. They knew he had entered the town. Word had gotten out. So even if he was trying to get away for a little R&R, if this was going to be a little teaching time for the apostles and without the crowd, it just didn't work. The people came to him. They flocked to him. He could not get away from them. And so we find here that here's this woman that comes to him, and she's Greek, she's non-Jewish, she's described as a Syrophoenician, so there's no doubt about the fact that she is not of Jewish descent. We remember the passage of Scripture, and we remember that the message of the Messiah was first and foremost for the Jews. And this explains this strange statement that Jesus makes. Allow the children, and I'm going to paraphrase as we go through, allow the children, that would be the Jews, to be satisfied first. Because it isn't right to take the children's or the Jews' bread and throw it to the dogs, the Gentiles. Wow. Jesus is not exactly politically correct here. He missed that class on how to win friends and influence people. How to word things so people will be more open. I mean, he just called this woman a dog. And in the Jewish mindset, that's what they were. Now, can you imagine that being in our evangelism plan? EE would start off with, "You dogs." Yeah, they would flock to us, wouldn't they? But he says this, why on earth did Jesus use the slang of the day talking about non-Jewish people to this woman when we know his heart is that people come to faith in Christ? And then if you think of it, we'll answer that question, but if you think about this analogy, what he was saying, think about our kids around the table. He said, the food is for the children first. Well, we get that. We want our kids to eat. But you and I both know if kids being kids, in most cases, you don't have to take the plates and scrape them. If the kids are eating, if the little dog's running around under the table, he's got a full meal deal. Okay? Yeah. The kids just, if you don't believe me, come over Wednesday night and look after the kids go. It's on the floor. They're messy. They're going to drop those crumbs. So the idea is that picture of the little home household pet, the little dog running around under the table and cleaning up after the children eating. That even though the dog is lesser in privilege than the child, it gets to eat almost at the same time because the children are dropping the crumbs. So Jesus is using this slang referring to the Gentiles. But before you get upset with him, let's look at what took place. Let's look at the bigger picture, because even before he said this, what was the posture of the woman? The Bible says in verse 25 that she fell at his feet. There was that picture of desperation, that picture of humility, of grief, of reverence. No, she wasn't a Jew, and he was a Jew, but she recognized there was something different about him, and the first thing she did when she got to him was fall down at his feet, acknowledging that, I'm not like you, I'm not worthy of this, but Lord, I've got a request. She falls at his feet, and then in verse 26 it says she kept asking him. So we're not getting the whole conversation here. It seems to me like he was almost preoccupied with something else, and she just kept on. And she would ask, and then he would keep on. And maybe he ignored her a little bit. Maybe he was trying to finish a conversation. I don't know what it looked like there, but I get the idea that it was a persistent asking. She kept asking. Now, that in itself takes humility. When someone's not immediately responding to you, I know at the house, when that happens with me, the question Jerry says, aren't you listening? And I might be preoccupied. Mine still works. She kept on in humility at his feet, requesting his grace. And when he says what he does, when he says allow the children to be satisfied first because it's not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs, I love her response. Lord, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. When faced with a statement that could have offended her, and by all rights probably should have offended her, she was so focused on her need that she didn't stop. She didn't let anything stop her. She responded with a desperate, logical response. It was like she was saying, Lord, just a crumb of your grace. Lord, just a smidgen of your grace. That'll be okay. I don't have to eat the full meal. I can just survive on the crumbs. Lord, I'm okay to be in a lesser position. I'm okay to be under the table. Lord, would you just give me a little bit? Just give me a little bit, even though I'm undeserving. I'm an undeserving dog. Just a little bit of your grace. Just a crumb. Lord, my child needs it. Please, Lord. Lord, the Jews might have precedence. But Lord, that doesn't exclude the Gentiles. Aren't you glad? Amen. Because we are the Gentiles. You see, her situation had her so desperate that she's a beautiful picture about the fact that the grace of God is within her reach. We see this woman humble, persistent in her faith. Now, once I throw that in there, some of you are going to remember and you're going to say, wait a minute, Pastor, you said a few weeks ago that faith isn't the point. No, I said faith is a vital part But it is not, but we don't get healing. In the instance we were dealing with, healing doesn't come as a reward for our faith. So this stuff about you've got enough faith and you don't have enough faith, so God would have healed if you hadn't had, that's just a bunch of bull. But faith is important. Faith is vital, and we see it here in this passage. In the synoptics of it, in Matthew chapter 15, verse 28, it says, "Then Jesus replied to her," and this is the same story just being told by Matthew, "Woman, your faith is great. Let it be done for you as you want." And from that moment on, her daughter was cured. We see another passage talking about great faith. Matter of fact, one of the two places in the Bible that it deals with it in this, and as Jesus was walking through the countryside in Matthew chapter 8, beginning with verse 5, dealing with the centurion's faith. And it says, "When he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, 'Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed in terrible agony.' Jesus said, 'I will come and heal him.' 'Lord,' the centurion replied, 'I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word and my servant will be cured. For I too am a man under authority, having soldiers under my command. I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it.' Hearing this, Jesus was amazed and said to those following him, 'I assure you, I have not found anyone in Israel with so great a faith. I tell you that many will come from the east and the west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.' And then Jesus told the centurion, 'Go, as you have believed, let it be done for you.' And his servant was cured at that very moment." In both instances, we find seekers of God's grace, and we find them in a humble attitude before God. They were both requests, and he said, "Lord, I'm not even worthy for you to come into the house. But Lord, if you'll do it, you can." Neither the centurion nor the Syrophoenician woman could be deterred from their request and their quest for grace. I mean, nothing would deter them. They were determined to stick with it, keep asking. In both instances, these folks were Greek, not Jewish. In both instances, Jesus healed from a distance. He didn't go lay hands on either one. He did it his way. You see, God's grace is within our reach. No matter who you are or where you are. Because of his grace, and because it's in your reach, don't give up. Keep asking. Keep inquiring. Keep asking God to give you his grace and to do what you need him to do in that desperate situation. Because of his grace, humble yourself before him. He is the answer. Humble yourself. Recognize who he is and who you aren't. Keep on asking. Don't be distracted by words or thoughts of discouragement. I mean, for most of us, and if you look at the world today, if somebody had said to somebody today what Jesus said to her, they would have been offended and walked away. Let me tell you, if you're desperate enough for the grace of God, you'll take anything to get it. You're not walking around with a chip on your shoulder and worried about who's who. And no, it's not that. It is, I need God's grace and I'll go through anything to get it. Call me whatever you want to because I know I'm not worthy. You see, the biggest problem most of us have of getting God's grace is our stinking pride. It's who I am. Well, I shouldn't have to do something like that. I shouldn't have to lower myself. And I need to realize that I'm not God. And it's humility that he's looking for. Don't be distracted. Don't be discouraged. God's grace is within your reach. And we see that with the woman crying out for her daughter to be relieved of these demons or this demon that is possessing her. And God, Christ, responded to her by answering her prayer, her request. But not only do we see that, we see God's grace is also without barriers. Look at verse 31 and following. Again, leaving the region of Tyre, he went by the way of Sidon to the Sea of Galilee through the region of the Decapolis. They brought him a deaf man, and we don't know who they are, doesn't matter. They brought him a deaf man who also had a speech difficulty and begged Jesus to lay his hand on him. So he took him away from the crowd privately. After putting his fingers in the man's ears and spitting, he touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed deeply and said to him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. Immediately his ears were opened, his speech difficulty was removed, and he began to speak clearly. Then he ordered them to tell no one, but the more he would order them, the more they would proclaim it. They were extremely astonished and said he had done everything well. He even makes deaf people to hear, and people unable to speak, to talk. Now, I want you to notice, first of all, in this part of the passage, just like the previous, we find intercessors. The woman went to him for her child, and now here are these group of they, these friends, who go to Christ for their friend. They bring their friend him, so they're interceding. This man could not speak for himself, and so they're interceding for him, and it's just a beautiful picture of what we're to be as Christians, intercessors, bringing people to Christ, going to Christ for others. The woman interceding for her daughter, these friends interceding, soliciting Jesus' help to heal this man, and they beg Jesus to lay his hands on him. Why did they ask him to do that? Could it be that they had seen him do it before? I mean, we've looked, as we've walked through the book of Mark, we've seen that. He's laid his hands on people and he's healed them. We see through Scripture where he lays his hands on people and they come back to life. And so, Lord, just lay your hands on him. And if he had chosen to do it that way, it would have worked. But isn't it interesting that he does things his way? You remember the man with the skin disease in the Bible? They told him to go wash, go dip himself, what was it, 7 times? Where? Oh, in the clean river. No. In the pool? No. The old nasty Jordan River. The dirtiest river around. Go dip yourself there and you'll be healed. Now let me tell you something. It was a bad place. It was stinky. It was dirty. Everybody there knew it. But what happened when he finally had the humility enough to go do it? The skin disease was gone. So sometimes Jesus does things and instructs us to do things in such a way that it requires humility on our part. As a matter of fact, it's the best way to come to it. Well, you think dipping in the dirty Jordan was tough? Look at this. And don't read it by reading things into it. Because that's normally what we do. Here's the picture we normally have. Jesus comes to him, he touches his, sticks his fingers in his ears, I guess, and spits, and then touches his tongue. He's not chewing tobacco now. Well, maybe the picture is he spits on the ground and makes mud. No, that was the blind man. What took place here? You see, we read it that way because that sounds reasonable to us. Let me read it to you in the Message. Some people brought a man who could neither hear nor speak and asked Jesus to lay healing hand on him. He took the man off by himself, put his fingers in the man's ears and some spit on the man's tongue. Did you hear that? He spit on a dude's tongue. Now, I don't know about you, I believe in the 5-second rule, okay? If I drop something on the ground and it's good to eat, 5 seconds, it's still clean. If it's got chocolate in it, we'll go 10 seconds. If I've been on the Atkins diet, 15, 20 seconds, it's still good. But let me tell you something. Don't mess with my toothbrush. I mean, Jerry and I have been married for 39 years this summer. And we've got this little container in our bathroom. Hers is one color and mine is another. If you want to see me change toothbrushes, just go in there and run that thing under the faucet and set it back up there. Because in my mind, somebody has stuck that in your mouth. And as husband and wife, we can swap spit all we want. But I'm not going to use somebody else's toothbrush or my toothbrush after somebody else has used it. Just can't do it. Can't go there. So we have a stash of them under the counter just in case she grabs the wrong one and wets it and then goes, oh, that's his, and sticks it back in there because I'm not touching that thing again. Look what this guy, look at this. Jesus, here's a picture. Now, I always wonder why he stuck his fingers in his ears. As I really got to reading this, I'm thinking maybe he stuck his fingers in his ears and used his thumbs to pry his mouth open. That's what he'd have to have done to me. And it literally says he spit on the guy's tongue. Maybe that's why he took him off to the side. Because nobody else was going to, I mean, they'd look at that and go, look, I don't know what he's got here, but I don't want any part of it. But let me ask you this. We can laugh about it, but let me ask you this. What are you willing to do? How humble are you willing to become to allow Jesus to administer grace to you in any way he chooses? You see, there are things we have happen in our lives that are tragic things that we need the grace of God. And we have to humble ourselves before him to receive that grace. There are things that happen to us in life that are by our own making that we have to get to the point where we can fall on our face and say, God, I did it. Humble ourselves enough to say, I did it. I did this to myself. It was because of my sin. God, I need your grace. And God, whatever it takes. And sometimes it takes making restitution to other people. Sometimes it takes going to people that know what's happened and asking them for forgiveness. Sometimes it takes humbling ourselves not only before God, but before others. Folks, whatever it takes, are you willing to do it to receive the grace of God? And I think that's the picture I get here. The more I studied this and the more I looked at this, God was delivering grace and he can do it any way he chooses. And some of it seems so unorthodox to us. But are you desperate enough for the grace of God, that grace of God that saves you, that grace of God that sustains you, that grace of God that will get you through it all, that will help you to live the Christian life, that will help you make it through the tough things of life? Are you desperate enough to say, God, do it anyway? Any way you choose. And sometimes he'll do it in ways that just don't make sense to us. But it's him. And he can do it any way he wants. I wonder how many times we have missed out on the grace of God because we've said, God, not going to do it that way. Yeah, Lord, I'll do anything you want me to do except that. Lord, there's got to be a plan B. What I found with God is there are no plan Bs. He says, this is the way we're going to do it. This is my way. Do it my way or forget it. And so we need that grace of God, and we need to be willing to humble ourselves, to be obedient enough, to be desperate enough to allow Jesus to deliver his grace however he chooses. And that's hard for me, because I have this huge thing called pride. And it's hard for me to stand still for some things. So I don't know what it is that God wants to do in your life or my life right now, but if he needs to stick his fingers in my ears and he needs to spit on my tongue, Lord, it's okay. I want to get to that place where I say, it's okay, it doesn't matter. Because God, it's not about me, it's about you, and then it's about me being right with you. And God, I'll take whatever it takes. I'll do whatever it takes. See, I think sometimes we've elevated Christianity to a level of a celebrity. And let me tell you, in America, that's flown pretty well for a while, but it's getting ready to stop. Because being a Christian isn't the cool thing anymore. And so there's going to be some things that if I'm going to stand for Christ and I'm going to receive the grace of God in my life on a daily walk, I'm going to have to go through some things that are not going to be that cool anymore. Am I willing to do it to receive the grace of God? Maybe you can't answer that question today. Maybe you can't say, yeah, I would stand there for him to poke his fingers in my ear and spit on my tongue. I just don't, and I'm not even asking for you to give me a verbal answer, but I'm asking you to search your heart and say, what am I willing? Where am I willing to allow him to do whatever he says, any way he wants to do it? The Gentiles of that day were very made to feel as very unworthy people, and Jesus is still in the Gentile territory, and he's delivering grace in the form of healing to another Gentile here. The healing on this occasion was immediate. It was the same as it was with the daughter. It was at a distance, and it appears that it was permanent. But as we look at these two events, what I also see, as we said, is that there are no barriers to God's grace. There's not a racial barrier that says, because I'm not one race or another, then I don't get God's grace. No, it's available no matter what your racial background is, whatever your racial makeup is, Jew, Gentile, it doesn't matter, black, white, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what your culture is. There are no cultural barriers. It doesn't matter what your physical makeup is. There are no physical barriers. But I'm going to tell you, the church has constructed some of those. Not intentionally, I don't think, today. In years past, yeah, it was intentional. But would we be open to anybody coming in? Anybody coming in of any form or fashion truly seeking to worship God? Or maybe not even truly seeking to worship God, just checking us out? And if they come in, how are we responding? Are we offering them the grace of God? Or are we saying, wait a minute, this is a barrier, we can't go there? According to this passage, there are no barriers. They can't be breached or gone beyond for God to reach us with his grace. Paul put it this way, for I am persuaded that not even death or life, angels or rulers, things present or things to come, hostile powers, height or depth or any other created thing will have the power to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. There's nothing, let me go on and just, I think when you can take and pull out of that passage and it's there, is that there's nothing I can do to move myself out of God's grace. Oh, but I'm ashamed of what I've done. Okay. That makes me humble. I can't live with what I've done. That makes me desperate. And God says, my grace is for you. He comes to where I am. He comes to where you are and says, here's the grace. Take it. I want to close with what we see take place in Mark chapter 7, verse 36. Jesus says, then he ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more they would proclaim it. When God's grace is bestowed upon you, you just can't keep it quiet. I told our Master Life groups yesterday, and I just mentioned it in the service this morning, that when we went to the phone store, this girl that was waiting on us, she had waited on me a couple of years ago, and so she knew we were with the church and so forth, and she said, when she tells me she's going to the concert, and I said, well, I went to the a Chris Tomlin concert here a while back. Did you go to that one? No, I didn't go to that one. What about the third day and that group? No, I didn't go to that one. She said, truth is, I wasn't a Christian then. Now, we're standing. Have you ever been into the cell phone store? There's a bunch of people around. This girl's standing there telling me this, and she said, I wasn't a Christian then, but I am now. And she said, you know what amazed me is I was up there, and she said, I was just worshiping God the other night. This is a young Christian, but an adult. And she says, I'm worshiping God. And she said, I looked around, and people around me are just sitting there. I only did that during, what's his name, Colton? I couldn't understand what he was singing. But she said, why are they excited about Christ? Now, I was a lot older. I am a lot older than she is. So I said, well, you know how us old people are. And she goes, no, these were youth. And she named the church, and I won't. Listen. When the grace of God touches your life, you're not going to sit there this way. When the grace of God really does something in your life, you're going to worship Him and you're going to praise Him and you're going to tell other people. And when He says, don't say anything, then you just can't help it. But we spend a lot of time talking about the Bible means what it means, and it meant the same thing then as now. But let me tell you something. This is one case that it doesn't. You say, what? Yeah, this doesn't. This rule doesn't go for us today. He doesn't tell us to be quiet. He doesn't call for silence. And you say, well, why? Well, Brooks puts it this way in his commentary. Jesus didn't want to be known as a Hellenistic miracle worker back then. And Mark reiterated that Jesus' true identity could not be understood until after the passion and the resurrection. That's why it doesn't apply to us anymore. Hey, folks, Easter has already passed. The first Easter is over. Jesus died on the cross. He rose again. Jesus is Christ. Jesus is the Messiah. And there's no secret anymore. There's not a path to the cross anymore. It's already been accomplished there. So to say, don't say anything because I'm not ready for people to know who I am. He was raised from the grave. They know, we know who He is. And we ought to be shouting it. We ought to be telling people that Jesus saves, Jesus is alive, Jesus heals, Jesus is your answer. He's got the grace and He's got it for you. We don't have that vow of silence anymore because He's not waiting to reveal Himself. He's not in the process of revealing Himself. He has been revealed. So I don't care what Bill O'Reilly says, there is proof that Jesus is Christ and Jesus is the Messiah. And we ought to write about it, and we ought to talk about it, and we ought to sing about it and worship because of it. His grace is sufficient. By grace are you saved through faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We're saved by grace, and let's start living by grace. Sometimes I think we got over the grace. Folks, you never get over the grace. It's the only reason we can live today is the grace of God. So I ask you, where are you in your walk? Are you to that place where you've been trying to figure out who Jesus is? You haven't accepted Him. You're not a follower of His necessarily. You have not committed your life to Him. Can I tell you His grace is available to you today? And His grace through the form of salvation, you just say, you humble yourself to say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Now, it's okay in this group because so are all the rest of us. Lord, I'm a sinner. And without you, I have no hope. And Lord, you died on the cross for me, and your blood paid the price for my sin, and you rose from the dead. So I put my faith in you because you're the only perfect one. And God, I put my faith in you, and I want to live for you. Today can be the day of your salvation, and you can receive the grace of God through your faith. If you're not sure quite how to do that, in just a moment, we're going to have an invitation. I'll be standing at the front. Josh will be standing here at the front. And if you come to either one of us, we'd love to share with you how you can have faith in Christ today and receive his grace. Maybe you've already done that and you haven't followed him in believer's baptism. You haven't gone through the waters of baptism, showing that picture of death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, of the fact that you've died to an old way of life and you're raised to a new life. Come join with us today through baptism. Maybe you're looking for a church home, a place to belong, a place to plug in, a place so that when you need intercessors, where there are things in your life, you can come to people and say, pray for me and pray with me. Go to God. I'm just trying to pray and I can't get through. Would you pray for me? And this is the place you can find that. Come join with us. Maybe you're going through an issue today. Maybe you've been going through an issue, whatever it is, and you just need the grace of God. Can I tell you, no matter what it is, you are not beyond the reach of his grace. Humble yourself, cry out to him desperately, and receive his grace.